Welcome back, everyone. We are so excited to continue our education series about the microbiome. Hopefully you remember last week or 2 weeks ago when Dr. O and Lauren talked about how important our microbiome is to our entire body and each body system. Hopefully you're already using PB Assist Plus and PB Assist Junior to assist your body in creating a healthy microbiome. Today, Dr. Brannick Riggs and Lauren are going to talk about how our lifestyle impacts our microbiome, both in a negative way and a positive way, and how each level of the lifestyle pyramid is also impacted by our microbiome. We have a jam-packed call for you today. We are really excited to share this with you. Over to you, Lauren.
Thanks, Jared. And today I am here with our VP of Education, the one and only Dr. Riggs.
Thank you.
So are you ready to try to accomplish the impossible today and discuss the entire wellness pyramid and microbiome in 15 minutes or less?
I'm actually excited about this, really discussing how small decisions that we make every day really has a large impact on our microbiome, either helping or sometimes giving us challenges on this.
Absolutely. So let's probably kick it off with nutrition and digestion.
That's great.
All right. Nutrition. This can be one of those tricky topics that people are like, I don't know what I should be eating. I don't know how much of an impact it really has on my health. And I think you have a whole bunch of knowledge to drop on us today about the impact on our microbiome.
Yeah, there's so much information out there now. So people are really, it's also kind of a polarizing conversation of we should eat this way and we should eat this way. And there are some things that we can glean from this. Like for instance, we know that a varied diet actually helps us in our microbiome. We know that fresh fruits and vegetables help us in our microbiome. We also know that there are certain things that cause challenges in our microbiome, such as eating fast food, right? Processed food changes the microbiome and starts in as little as an hour after eating a fast food meal.
So one meal can have an impact.
One meal. And then we often think, well, I'm just going to take a vacation. I'm just going to be gone for 10 days. It's not a big deal. But there's research out of the King's College in London that indicates that if you eat fast food or processed food for 10 days, you lose up to 40% of the diversity of your microbiome. That's 1,400 species that die off because you're eating highly processed food.
Okay, so people don't throw it out the window. If they mess up on one meal, does that mean the whole day is shot?
So, great point. We often will kind of throw out the baby with the bathwater. Like, oh, I ate some processed food and Dr. Riggs said my microbiome changes in an hour. But the good news is, it doesn't change everything in an hour. We can then say, okay, so I went on a trip and was hungry, so I stopped by a fast food place, but then you just get right back on the bandwagon, right? It's really those choices every single day, like we've talked about earlier, that lead to a significant shift in all this. It's not just the one time. So every time we make a decision about the whole wellness pyramid, sleep, movement, nutrition, metabolism, exercise, all those things, really the accumulation is what really affects our microbiome.
I love that. So we got to hear from Dr. O and he talked about the importance of diversity. And you just brought it up again and how our diet impacts the diversity of our microbiome. So do you want to dive into that a little bit?
Yeah, so there's kind of up to 5,000, around 5,000 different species that live in our gut particularly. Now we're not talking about skin, we're not really addressing oral and respiratory yet. But when we talk about just our gut, there's about 5,000 different species in our microbiome. And what we do and what we eat changes what happens in there, which species are supported, which species feel less supported. And then they in turn emit certain chemicals through their and hormones through their metabolism that then teaches our system what to do. So for instance, we know that certain bacteria in our microbiome increase gut permeability, which then means we deal with some challenges of things getting through that lining that shouldn't be there. And then we know that certain other of the bacteria will actually help seal that up. And so then we're not absorbing those things that can be bad for us.
So would it be fair to say if I happen to add brownies into my diet on a daily basis, the more often I eat brownies, I'm feeding bacteria that are like carbs, bring them on.
Yep.
And I'm gonna crave brownies more often?
Actually, they will do that. They send messages to the brain telling your brain, you're hungry for more carbohydrates, right? But the reverse is also true. Mm. If we're eating good fruits and vegetables, having healthy proteins, et cetera, what happens is they send messages to the brain, helping us to crave more of those. You hear people tell us over time, boy, when I made this dietary switch, the first few days was hard because they were overcoming those, you know, messages. Influences to the brain, telling them, reach for the brownies.
Yeah.
But then they say after that, it became much easier. It's because the messages started changing from their microbiome, telling them, you're craving fruits and vegetables. It's much better for you. Those fiber is what we need, and those nutrients are what we need.
Okay, so next we're moving into movement and metabolism, and let's just go ahead and kick it off with the hard one, movement.
Yeah.
We hear about the importance of exercise, getting out and moving. Does it have an impact on our microbiome as well?
Yeah, you wouldn't think so, right? I mean, it seems like a kind of a strange connection between, well, I've got to exercise and it affects my microbiome. But the truth is, research is telling us now that it does change things, right?
Wow.
That it does change our gut permeability. It changes the support or not support of certain bacteria within our gut. And so getting out and exercising every day is vitally, vitally important for us. Research published in 2021 in the Frontiers magazine said that moderate athletes with moderate activity, which is their normal amount.
So not climbing mountains all day long.
Right. Exactly. So a normal amount of exercise actually supports a healthy microbiome and gives us certain messages to continue that activity. So just like the food, right?
Yeah.
Eating certain foods helps give that message. Also, the research tells us that really, really high intensity exercise, there can be too much of a good thing, actually changes gut permeability and changes the microbiome. What's fascinating is their microbiome changes to be better able to handle carbohydrates, which often high-intensity athletes are eating, and helps them handle blood sugar better to sustain it longer. So yes, it may do some problems, but it also changes the microbiome to support the activity that they're doing. So those that are marathon runners, those that are running those 100-mile races, which is amazing to me, actually change their microbiome by doing those things.
So too much exercise could actually cause a stress response. So we'll go into to stress and rest in a minute.
Yeah.
But you're saying that also our body is adapting to the fuel sources necessary for survival.
Yeah. Okay. Amazing, right? That we're teaching our body. Again, we go back to this concept of each decision we make within the wellness pyramid is either supporting or giving us some more challenges. And so those little decisions we make every day really are the thing that's teaching our microbiome what we want it to do.
Okay, so next is metabolism. And I'm sure pieces of this come in from both movement and from nutrition, right?
Yeah, absolutely. So metabolism, we know that the microbiome supports metabolism. One of the interesting things that we found is that when we replace the microbiome with healthy microbiome in individuals, it actually changes their metabolism. Fascinating thing that we have learned over the years of doing checking people's microbiome and then doing fecal transplants, which I know sounds like a weird thing, but we've had to do it in certain situations in the medical field. And when we replace that unhealthy microbiome in the gut with someone's microbiome that's healthy, all of a sudden their metabolism changes.
Amazing.
So it affects us even at that level. I have had patients in the past that have weighed much more than they wanted to weigh, but were dealing with a certain issue that when we had to do the fecal transplant, they lost an immense amount of weight without changing anything in their lifestyle, just by changing their microbiome.
Amazing.
So cool.
So last week we actually heard Dr. O drop the term invisible organ, except for I heard you expand on that, and I would love to hear more about that.
So it's not just considered an invisible organ, it's now considered because of the messages that it gives out to the rest of the body and the messages that it receives from us, it's really now considered an invisible endocrine organ. So think about things like thyroid, pancreas, adrenals, all of those things. Now we add microbiome to that list because it does affect our system as a whole.
I love that. Okay, so that's a great segue to dive into rest and manage stress, because I think some of us have possibly heard of the gut-brain axis before. We have that link between our gut health and our mental health, but you're also talking about our lifestyle factors that impact and may cause an outside stress response.
Mm-hmm.
But then how's our body responding internally and what's the impact on our microbiome?
Yeah, that's a great, great question. So we know that cortisol, which is what we emit when we're under stress, right? That fight or flight response. We know that cortisol affects our microbiome dramatically. When we're stressed, so is our gut.
Yeah.
right? So we don't get to avoid that stress response changing our gut. And the microbiome then changes based upon that stress response.
And some of us are probably familiar with that. When we felt really stressed, we got that knot in our stomach. Right. We may feel a little bit nauseous. So it's more than just a gut feeling.
Yeah, yeah, it's true. And often we talk about it in this way because we say, oh, I just got a sick feeling in my gut. It's because we're under stress.
Yeah.
It isn't just a saying. It's a for real thing that's happening to us that we're experiencing in real time on that.
So how about sleep? Does sleep have any impact on the microbiome?
Oh, of course it does, because we've talked about every aspect of the wellness pyramid does.
Yeah.
So when it comes to sleep, we know that the diversity of microbiome that we have in our gut actually impacts efficiency of sleep, the quality of sleep that we get, and how long we're sleeping. In addition to that, certain bacteria also help us with short-chain fatty acid production, which then helps us with serotonin production, which 90% of serotonin made in the GI tract.
Yep.
And then that serotonin is metabolized into melatonin. We know the great benefits of melatonin there. So absolutely, sleep impacts all of that. And as you might imagine, that impacts sleep in turn. Again, that system back and forth between messages we're giving it and messages it's giving us.
Yeah.
Back and forth.
So lifestyle factors.
Yeah.
Supporting the microbiome. All good outcomes so far.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Great.
So how about we move into what kind of lifestyle aspects are probably having a negative impact on our microbiome? And we dive into a little bit about reduced toxicity.
Yeah. There are some things out there that affect us, right?
How about cleaners? Because I think the messaging for so long has been, you want to, 99% of germs, right? We want to kill and abolish everything from everywhere.
Yeah.
And we're spraying it all over our house. And then our little kids are like sucking on the counter. And like, is this having an impact on our microbiome?
Absolutely it is. We know that cleaners contain some chemicals that can cause problems with our microbiome. And I really like to encourage my parents to let their kids go out inside and play in the world, right? Because getting exposure to the microbiome, getting exposure to playing in the dirt, building mud pies, playing in the plants is really helpful for us. And when we sterilize our world, our system doesn't handle that well. We really have to be exposed to all these things. And so sterilizing everything around us can be problematic for our skin microbiome, our intestinal microbiome, our respiratory microbiome. So it's healthy for us to have some exposure to some of these things.
But I would assume that there's still some times that we are okay to want to get rid of the germs.
Absolutely. So for instance, if I'm out using a restroom out in the public and for some reason there's not a place to wash my hands afterwards, then I might reach for my On Guard sanitizing spray. I need to get rid of some of those germs that I've been exposed to in a restroom that I just don't want on my hands. However, it's not something I'm going to take out all the time, constantly spray my hands over and over again, because then I'm dealing with a sterile microbiome on my hands. I don't want that. I want the normal microbiome. Even antimicrobial soaps that are so popular today can sterilize this microbiome on the skin. So making sure that we're just using regular soap and water to wash our hands, as opposed to the sterilizing antimicrobial soaps or the sterilizing sprays constantly, will actually help us have a normal microbiome on our skin, which I think is really, really good for us. And I know that Dr. O talked about this issue of alcohol mouthwashes sterilizing the microbiome of the mouth, and that is absolutely true. Now, beautifully, our On Guard mouthwash doesn't have alcohol in it. It's water-based, so it doesn't have that same effect on our oral microbiome as other mouthwashes out on the market will do.
So points that really need to stick in.
Yeah.
Not all germs are bad.
Correct.
Diversity is key.
Correct.
And use the right tools at the right time,
yeah,
when appropriate. Okay, so last place we get to dive into, informed self-care. Yeah. And really being engaged in the decisions of the products that we're using to be able to support our body based on what our needs are. And you have a phrase that I totally love.
Yeah.
Just because we, how's it go?
Just because we make it doesn't mean you have to take it, right? We should be addressing certain things with the products that we have, but it doesn't mean we have to be taking everything all the time. I really have a foundational recommendation for the products that we should be taking kind of across the board. That's going to be LLV. This is adults. LLV, MetaPower Advantage, and then our probiotic product. Those three things are foundational, non-negotiable. Beyond that, then, It's really, what are the things in my lifestyle that I need to address? Oh, I've been running a whole lot and I'm really active, so therefore I'm gonna add deep blue polyphenols or turmeric or copaiba or deep blue rub. Or I'm dealing with some digestive concerns, so I'm gonna reach for the Digestzen products and add to that. In my case, when I travel, I reach for Terrazyme. I don't take it every single day, but I do take it when I need it because I'm addressing certain concerns. So really selecting all of these things that we have, beautiful products, and saying, this is when I need this, this is when I need this. It's really that concept that I've been taught of, what are you hiring the product to do? What do I need to do in my system, and which product is gonna affect that?
Okay, so if you're trying to figure out what products do I need to incorporate into my lifestyle, into my daily routine, we have the Wellness Lifestyle Assessment. It's an easy way to kind of see where those gaps are. You have your wellness advocate you can turn to, right? We have our teams that we love to rely on, and they're teaching us all the time. And I believe we have something coming up really cool in the next 2 weeks.
So next week, we're gonna hear from Alex DeBell. He's gonna talk to us about this kind of myth of colonization. And as I said, for me, a daily probiotic is a non-negotiable. It's every single day. And he'll talk about why that's important. He'll also talk about what is good to look for in a quality probiotic and why we at doTERRA have made the choices we have to create this product and how amazing it is. I'm actually so excited about this. This is gonna be great.
So not all probiotics are created equal.
Oh, absolutely not. And it's been the challenge over the years. You know, in the 90s, the research on the probiotic world was really telling us you probably shouldn't be using it. But the challenge was, it wasn't great quality of a product. Matter of fact, when you looked at some of them, when we look at colony-forming units, there were zero in some of those, which then would tell you, well, when you take this product, there is no benefit, so don't take a probiotic. Now the technology's gotten so much better, and we're so much better at creating products like this one that doTERRA has, that you're gonna see incredible amounts of benefits with taking something that we're producing.
Sounds great. Can't wait to hear all of Alex's brilliance on our next call. Back to you, Jared.
Thanks, Lauren and Dr. Riggs. I really appreciated learning about how my lifestyle impacts my microbiome on a daily basis and how I need to make conscious decisions every single day to use my PB Assist, my PB Assist Junior, to keep my microbiome healthy. Now, we've got a great surprise for you. Those of you who have PB Assist Plus or PB Assist Junior on your LRP templates in August or September, we're going to upgrade you to the new surprise products that are coming at convention at no extra charge. Speaking of convention, make sure you get your tickets today. The education we're going to be sharing is beyond even what we're able to share here on these calls. So get them today. Join us next week as Alex DeBell shares with us his knowledge on how to select the best microbiome product. Remember, your microbiome is speaking. Join the conversation. See you next week.